Welcome to another Salukabu's podcast, Bihar elections special. And here we are capitalizing on the ongoing Bihar elections hashtag trend, just like every other media company, and trying to be a view grabber. But that's not the only purpose. I thought there's not going to be much coverage on the Bihar election because the media is so busy chasing drugs on the WhatsApp messages. So I thought this would be a really appropriate time to humble attempt to divert the attention towards the upcoming elections, which I believe are one of the biggest elections in the view of the pandemic. And I'm not sure our generation has seen an election in a pandemic last time. So we have a couple of my one of them is one of my favorite political scientists and analysts, with whom I have been following on the online space for a long time. And she tagged along one of her esteemed best friends, Professor Sarthak. Am I right, sir? Professor? Did I get that right?
Yeah.
Right. I was this close to calling him a doctor, but nevertheless, he's a professor on his way to be a doctor. And he is, again, a political analyst. I will let them introduce themselves. And but I think you're in for a fascinating analysis of the upcoming Bihar elections. Why don't you please introduce yourself and just tell us why we have to believe your votes rather than referring to the wonderful analysis of Republic TV.
I can go first. My name is Sarayu Natarajan. I am the founder of Apti Institute, which is a public research institution that looks at the intersection of tech and society. And my interest in politics stems from my PhD work, but also because I used to co-host a podcast called Ganatantra. So that's me. And why you should believe us, you should never believe anybody, and one should always be critical is what I'd say. But over to you, Sarthak.
Right. And thank you, Sarayu. And I think why I would first answer that question, why you should believe us. I mean, first of all, we are not shouting, so probably you can hear us better because we won't be interrupting each other when they speak. So probably you will be able to hear all of us out and then go ahead and question us or probably look into some of the aspects that we talk about here today. So I am Sarthak Bakshi. I teach at the School of Arts and Sciences at Ahmedabad University. I'm a political scientist by training, and I have worked for my PhD. I worked out on informal politics and clientelistic politics in Bihar and Maharashtra. So Bihar has been my field of study for the last 6 years. And this will be the second election that I will be, actually the third, because I also studied the 2019 parliamentary elections in Bihar. So this will be the third election, but of course I'm remote studying it from the social media handles and other, following the digital space where the virtual election campaigns are going to happen. And yes, of course, this is definitely going to be a very special election because this is going to be the first major election that will happen under pandemic, and we are talking about voting. Voting roll of about 80 million people. So by the second phase of Bihar, which starts on 3rd November, that will be the polling day in US. So till then, we are the biggest election which will happen in the first phase. So that is something even was declared by the Election Commission when declaring the dates. And of course, like you just said, Najib, that it is actually happening in unprecedented times. And let us discuss more about that.
Sarayu, I'm a total what you can call me, totally unaware of what the electoral process is. All I know is just go and press the button, vote, right? So how early do parties generally start preparation for an assembly election like this in your experience?
Well, I don't think there's any one answer to that. And Sarthak should also weigh in here. Different parties and different circumstances warrant different approaches. And I think that typically election or matters that are likely to become issues in the subsequent election can start to get raised up to a year before. Some newspaper will hint that this is an election issue, so it's being brought up. There's always this discussion. But one must also place that in context of the way in which electoral politics in a liberal democracy works, right? So it's never that the next election is off your mind entirely, right? So it's not like the moment you get elected, you're secure and you say, well, 4 years from now, 365 days to the elections, we will start our campaign. So parties, political parties, particularly ground level functionaries, are constantly in some phase or frame of mind of thinking of some kind of election. So that's one. And that means, and Sartha can talk more to it, and a lot of my doctoral work also revolved around the ways in which like local political leaders use strategies to continue to build vote bases, right? So that's the first thing. The second, the timing is more complex because there's always some other election that's happening, right? So there are state assembly elections which are timed typically at 5 years, but in Karnataka, as you know, well, not elections, but you know, governments have been changing.
Yeah.
But there's also sort of local elections, municipal elections, right, in the urban areas, in the rural areas, there are panchayats, Zilla Parishad elections, like a range of elections. So it's not like it's ever off the table. But typically, like in the context of big elections, things start getting discussed about a year. And about a year in advance, but it's more like a heuristic and one shouldn't just, you know, think about it in that frame alone.
Right. Sarthak, traditionally, who is more proactive? Who starts early in Bihar? Which party, as far as your experience goes?
So again, to weigh in on this question, basically, election preparations happened on two scales, if we largely divide it. I mean, one is on the party level, but also on the constituency and the candidate level. And for my doctoral work, I've been trailing following closely candidates or, you know, constituency level leaders. And like Saru said, I mean, it's a continuous affair. I mean, they are always this phrase was used for Narendra Modi in 2014. He was called like a constant campaigner. And I think something of similar is, applicable to all the leaders. And in fact, there are in constituencies, there are people who are also aiming or vying for a ticket. So they are also projecting themselves, right? So these will be people who will already 2 years, 3 years before the election date, they will already be strengthening their networks and creating a kind of a cadre and doing social work and, you know, the visibility of being seen and doing things and getting things done. So these are important aspects through which people project their, arrival on the political scene. So these things keep on happening. And it's, politics is a 24/7 game. There is never a dull moment. So the moment you take off for a holiday in Bangkok or in Europe, you know what are the pitfalls of that, some leaders do. But so definitely, like they say, that there is no break in politics. And also, I know that, let's say some specific cases or like, say, let's, an example like Jignesh Mevani, whom I've also been studying. So they have been doing things once they are elected, but over 2 years or 3 years before the re-election comes up, they strengthen or they reinvigorate their engagement with the constituency, start going to the constituency more and having these weekend visits and getting more things done and organizing camps in the constituency. So these are all ways in which individual level leaders also do. But again, like sir, you said that at a party level, things start at a much later later stage. And that probably is also aimed at creating the narrative. And the parties are more, interested in creating the narrative at the state level or at the provincial level. So that starts probably a year, because anything before a year will be
forgotten.
It's again a very short, will be forgotten because it's a short memory. So anything, it will not be, registered in the memory, or it will not have what brand managers use, the recall value.
Yeah.
So that is the way probably things are operating as far as I have seen in the context of India.
What you're saying is basically the cycle of WhatsApp message forwarding, new factory opening, new roads laying will all start within the reach of the election is all what you're trying to get to. Yeah.
So a lot of work will be done. So local level work will keep on happening, right?
Right.
But then linking that work with a slogan, say Atmanirbhar Bihar. The constituencies which I have been studying, there have been constantly, building openings and college openings or something. But then linking them to Skill India or linking them to Atmanirbhar Bihar or other things. So then, things keep on happening at the constituency level. But then linking them to the mega narrative or the meta narrative created by the party, that starts closer to the date of the election, so that it helps in bringing putting together a campaign.
Yeah.
Sorry, if I may jump in also, you know, just to reiterate the point, like every moment for a politician in a certain way is a political moment, and at all levels, right? So whether it's the inauguration of a small hand pump, or, you know, I used to observe in the place where I did my field work, and, you know, even continues till now, a local leader would play a role in, you know, getting the municipality to bring the water tanker. And then he would come, he would be wearing his party symbol on his shirt and sitting on the tanker with, you know, so it's not like it ever goes away. And so one must remember, like Sarthak, you know, completely precisely pointed out, is the linkage happens at different points of time, depending on, you know, what is being solved for in some ways. But it's every moment is a political moment.
Right.
Just one distinction is that, closer to the election date, what happens is the agency of the voters, that increases. And then they are able to pressure and they are able to actually dictate these terms of engagement. So that the balance probably tilts more in favor of the voters closer to the election date. But rest of the time, it is actually tilted in favor of the politician who is still seen as somebody who is a provider.
Right.
But closer to the election date, what has happened due to this, you know, continuity of the democratic exercises, and again, more or less free and fair election electoral system, voters have actually gathered that strength, and the balance closer to the date of the campaign and closer to the date of the polling, that balance shifts a little bit towards them. So that is the only distinction probably.
Right. Sarayu, is this an election where digital media and digital campaigning has been more important as it has ever been in the history of Indian elections, right? Because yesterday the election commission has released the restrictions, no more than 2 cars in the rally, no more than 3 cars in the nominations and so on, right? So how key, should there be a regulation on digital space in times like this? Because, you know, you never know what information is flowing through a WhatsApp group or a Facebook group, and you have literally no control over it, right?
That's a fantastic question, and profoundly difficult to answer. But I'll answer it in two parts. Like the first part around, is this historically different in a certain way? And then the second is, how do you start to think about building, you know, regulations or responses in a certain way? So on the first part, like, I think the pathways to fully digital elections have been in the works for a while. So it's not something that is a shift that's occurred suddenly or entirely precipitated by the pandemic, right? What the current situation and the current sort of COVID-19 crisis has done is it has become very imperative to be digital, but elections have been digital now for quite some time. I think starting 2014, that was a big shift in a certain way. But 2014 also, I think, depending on the context, depending on access to digital devices, might have had sort of huge variation. But you're starting to see greater and greater homogeneity in the way elections are fought across constituencies, across territories, across sort of different contexts, come together to sort of resemble each other. Now that, of course, and we can, you know, come back to discussing that, has quite complex effects, like the local issues in some ways get subsumed because you're only thinking of the big top level issues.
Yeah.
It also leads to, in some ways, the disenfranchisement of local political leaders. So it's they feel very powerless because the messages are all coming from, in a certain way, some central entity.
Yeah.
So their ability to navigate their particular social circumstances is taken away. So this is a process that's been happening for a long time, and to characterize it as one that's only come from this is, I think, a little bit specious. But having said that, you know, COVID has precipitated it, that it you know, has to happen over entire territories, right? And so areas where there is no digital literacy also, then you still have to find a way to reach communities and constituents digitally. The other thing, of course, to keep in mind is, you know, over the last few years, the access to data and access to the internet has remarkably increased, right? So you have to only look at the numbers to sort of say. So I think this is very much, you know, a process, and therefore any response shouldn't therefore come entirely from the frame of saying this election or this circumstance, but more broadly ask, what are the problems, what are the breakdowns with the use of digital media in the political process, right?
Right.
And there are some apparent things for elections and some like less apparent ones, right? Hmm. So the more apparent ones are things like disinformation and misinformation that are very much transmitted through these social media channels, and there's no visibility on it. There's also no sort of question of credibility. There's also no question of how do you put it, like a verification process. So anybody with a keyboard can send any message, and in a certain way, just because it appears in text and in some cases even voice, it becomes validated as true, but there's no sort of external benchmarking or real validation. So I think, I mean, and so there's, you know, definitely there's also the collapse of the community in a certain way, which is what this kind of technology does, is that it focuses on individuals. So it's about your phone, your consumption of digital news, your sort of engagement with the state, and never really thinking about sort of communal relations, etc.
Right.
Now, what that means, and especially, and the digital divide works in very much the same way that social divides operate, right? Those who are disadvantaged in society are disadvantaged digitally. And I can speak, for example, to the case of women, right? Whose access to phone, technology, everything is mediated by the patriarchal structure. So then when you begin to think about, let's say, women and their participation in politics, right? That somehow becomes very complicated now when you think of what do digital elections do to democratic structures or democratic participation. So regulation must also, you know, not just think about reducing the harms, but also think about how do you in some ways increase democratic participation. And in some way, like the voting booth is an easy, it's a simple, it's an easy to understand kind of thing, but that's not necessarily true of the digital world. And therefore, you know, those who are disadvantaged, how do you think about including them is something to talk about,
right,
from the regulatory perspective. I don't know regulation, but from as a discussion, like, you know, this needs to be talked about a lot more.
Sarthak, who has their social media game figured out in Bihar as of now? It's not really a digital state, right? So who has it figured social media wise? Who is not really losing much because they don't have this digital reach? And what are your thoughts on that?
So, yeah, I mean, like you have rightly pointed out, there is a very big, like, you know, I mean, a digital gap, actually. I mean, the divide happens when there is something to divide it with. Before that, reaching itself, because I think there was this article in The Quint recently, which used the TRAI data for March and April 2020. And it showed that Bihar, rural Bihar, has a digital penetration of only about 30%. And urban Bihar is also like, it's falling way behind other big urban areas in India, like where it is all over 90%. In urban Bihar, it's about 75% or something. So Bihar is definitely lagging behind, right? In like all other, many other aspects, even in the digital scope. Now, the question is that, I mean, I've been actually scraping through with help from some interns. I've been actually scraping through some of the Twitter profiles, right? And Twitter profiles of different political parties and different, you know, politicians, major politicians. Now, I mean, barring a few like, you know, Nitish Kumar or Lalan Singh, who is the party spokesperson, or Tejaswi Yadav or Sushil Kumar Modi, no other political, you know, person, political leader in Bihar has a very big social media presence, whether be it on Twitter or be it on Facebook, right? We do see that, again, for Bihar is a very young state also because it has a lot of young voters. But somehow, I wonder, because Instagram is so big, right, with the young population. I mean, barring a few, I think only one party which has an Instagram account, which is a new party, again, VIP, Vikasshil Insan Party. Other parties are not that prominently present on Instagram. They don't have that kind of footprint. Facebook is becoming a big platform, and we see that a lot of the parties are actually going big on Facebook Live, and they're doing these kind of, you know, Sunday Samvad. Every week, every day they're having, every week, Sunday weekend, they're having their spokespersons going on live and discussing things with, you know, the people. And you see that there is a big participation. I would say that Bihar, in Bihar, BJP and RJD have till now like been able to harness that kind of a, you know, footfall in social media lives and in their social media accounts, right? But again, in terms of information, in terms of, you know, what is the party agenda, what are the party objectives, what are the narrative, what are the promises and other things. RJD just, I think, 2 weeks or 10 days ago, I think, they put up their website. I think a week back, they put up their new website. So nothing, information was available about the party, right? BJP has been doing it. And again, BJP Facebook has a lot of these, posts or kind of small video snippets or a lot of these posters, which highlight their, you know, their objectives, their aims, their promises, or poll promises, or something like I said, the Atmanirbhar Bihar scheme. So a message from the leader. So they are able to definitely use these mediums more effectively. Again, like Saryu pointed out, that this is not just the, you know, not just the development of this time. It has been in the making. And those who were early to the game definitely have an early mover advantage. And clearly Bihar, BJP does stand, you know, ahead of others in the game. But then the point is that how much is this visibility, social media visibility, how much is that relevant, right? Because we have to understand that for elections, what matters is not how many people you get to the crowd, get to the ground for a rally, but how many people you are actually able to get to the polling booth, right? Again, BJP says that they have their booth adhyaksh and booth level committee and other things, WhatsApp committee, and very granular level monitoring is happening on the WhatsApp groups and all that. And but so is RJD is also having some things similar, right? Maybe these are not well advertised or these are not, but at a community level, these because RJD, barring BJP, RJD is the only party which has a very strong cadre base,
right?
In Bihar, JDU is, organizationally, it is very, you know, dysfunctional despite being in power for so long, and it is generally a one-man show, which is, right, again, which again Lalu was also, but still RJD has a very strong ideologically committed also, but also grassroots level workers. Yeah. And so that network is very important in spiraling down a message or conveying a message and taking it down to the workers, right? I mean, I would recall one incident or one observation from 2015 campaign that, BJP brought out these kind of big digital rath, right? Mm-hmm. They call these vans, which were fitted with screens. And in that screen, Modi's message would be playing out and Amit Shah's, you know, speech would be playing out. And I saw that many times on the crossroads in Samastipur, Darbhanga, and many other areas where I was doing field work. And I saw them, that people would gather around these, right? You know,
right.
But the point with that is, with that van is, it's a one-way communication.
Right.
Only what Modi was able to tell or wanted to convey was being told to the audience who
which
had
is the case,
there, right?
Which is the case every time, sir, but sorry, go on.
Which is the case every time, but in a digital thing, it gets reinforced,
yep,
right?
Yep.
Whereas the Grand Alliance, which was Nitish and Lalu together, they had these very nice cycle pracharak. They had these cycle pracharaks in which they had a cycle, and in that cycle, there was Nitish had 7 promises. So all those 7 promises were listed, and there were these pamphlets and leaflets with the cycle rider, right? And that rider was supposed to go and cover about 4 or 5 panchayats in a day. And he would go to each panchayat and he would hold a meeting, or he would be distributing these pamphlets and he would talk to those people, like to inform them and to get them engaged and hooked up to the campaign. So there is a very kind of an active engagement and a passive engagement. So I think that difference is very important. Now, again, we see that RJD also this time too, I've seen that they have also made these digital rath. So instead of using something positive from one campaign that has already worked for them in 2015, they're actually falling in the trope of what the BJP is highlighting about, you know, the idea of digitization and digital race, that kind of a thing.
But what about the TV channels, Sarthak? I mean, I live in Bangalore, but I come from Andhra Pradesh, and every party has its own mouthpiece. What can you tell about the mouthpieces of various parties in Bihar, if you can? Is there a Fox News?
So Bihar actually, I mean, it doesn't really have I mean, I'm not very sure whether it has that kind of a mouthpiece, but we know that nowadays it is very difficult to make a, you know, kind of a distinction between, you know, which is actually representing for which party.
Right.
So you have certain regional channels like Kashish News is there and Z Bihar is there, which are doing a lot of good ground coverage. TV9 is there, and also Sahara Samay probably. These are, you know, these have a massive rural coverage. But I think more than the TV penetration, it's still the newspapers which are more source of news, and definitely the vernacular, the regional newspapers. And in that, we have Prabhat Khabar, we have Dainik Bhaskar, we have Hindustan. These are the places where you will find that the narrative and the discourse is taking shape. And like I think Sadhu pointed out, and the importance of these newspapers is that these newspapers are places in which, you know, reading the newspaper happens at a community level. So people actually gather together near the panchayat, you know, office or near the big tree in the village, and they discuss the points mentioned. Right. And there, the point is that it allows the point for a discussion. Mm. What the digital thing is basically insulating people and making them into closing them into silos. And I think that is a big kind of a it doesn't let people to engage with democracy.
There is no counterpoint, because when you're in a room, you are only echoing your own point in the message that you're reading. Right. But when you're with five people, when you say something stupid, there will be a counter.
Yes. So, I think, Taru, please.
No, absolutely. I think there's another dimension to media, media coverage of elections, and the extent to which it manifests in Bihar, I'm not precisely aware of, but there's also like the bad, what social media does in a certain way, and this sort of steers away from the point around, you know, how digital media makes people into silos. But, you know, stepping aside, what it also does is it reduces the barriers for entry for anybody to generate content. Right. Now imagine, this podcast wouldn't exist if not for super high fast broadband. Of course, you know, a lot of other things come into play, and I'm sort of oversimplifying here, but there's no barriers to entry, right? Three of us got together 6 emails later, and you know, we're recording this podcast. What that also means is that it gives very many people the opportunity to generate media, right? Mm-hmm. And to generate content. There is a preference for video and audio. We already know that. Therefore, simultaneously, there's much more content being produced. So there's they're not really channels as such. And I think there's been a couple of articles. Venkat Anant wrote a piece in ET a few weeks ago. Then there are a couple of other pieces. They're not coming to me to my mind immediately, but that talk about the growth of sort of ground level journalists, ground level writers, ground level content generators who are in different platforms. So it's not necessarily something that is directly visible on news television, or like, it's not on your DTH cable service, right? But it's there on Facebook, it's YouTube channels. It's just, you know, like these WhatsApp groups that disseminate information and then that acquire their own life of virality. Yeah. But it's not necessarily visible in the way that classic TV channels are. The other point to keep in mind about this whole digital, right, is like a platform transferability that happens. Like, it's very easy now to record something that's on television, and it could be a partisan channel, like your NTV or your Jaya TV or whatever else, right? I'm from Hyderabad too, and I'm also partly Tamil, so these are the two states that have really perfected the art of partisan television, right?
But
here you have the ability to sort of take content and spread it and disseminate it in very targeted ways. And I think that's something digital enables that one should be very, you know, cognizant of in thinking about the way in which the nature of elections has changed. So, to keep in mind.
If I can just come in, Najib.
Yeah.
So, I mean, very important. So, I mean, I was just reading this. So, I was developing this course on populism, right? And in which I'm using this article I saw in The Atlantic by Applebaum, right? Anna Applebaum. And actually, she talks about this information bubbles, right? And how this digital communication and this digital medium, it creates these information bubbles, and
yeah.
it definitely helps in amplifying the narrative, but it does it in such a way that it is actually going from one bubble to another. So it's actually not able to break these bubbles, but getting passed on, creating more bubbles in itself, right? So, I mean, just today, I'm on a WhatsApp group from Bihar, and I got this message on the WhatsApp group, which actually uses the same thing that Saru pointed out, that it uses a clip from one of these award shows, right? And in these award shows, these stars make a lot of mockery and they laugh at themselves, right?
Yeah.
So you will have there was a clip of Shah Rukh Khan and some other actor making fun of some newcomers. And there they were showing Sushant Singh's face again and again. So somehow that kind of a clip is being, you know, put and it's being, you know, viralized in a, yeah. in a WhatsApp message to show and to remind people that, you know, BJP cultural cell has actually come out with a poster, right?
Yeah.
Na bhule hai, na bhulne denge. That means we have not forgotten and we will not allow anybody to forget it. So, I mean, these are different ways of, you know, propagating a message further
yeah.
and spiraling it into something which is which probably did not exist, but just creating it.
Right.
So I think it's very important. We have to also understand these.
We will get to that particular news that you had shared, Sarthak. I would have to move on to the next topic, which is caste, right, Sarayu? It's ultimately. Is an election in India ultimate about, ultimately, is it about, you know, getting a bunch of caste on your side? Is that what it is all about at the end of the day, in at least on an assembly level, if not on a national level?
I would hesitate to answer that in definitive terms. Mm-hmm. I think, yes, caste is very relevant. It's very relevant in social life. It's very much relevant in politics as well. Some of the politics around caste, particularly when you think about caste as a political artifact alone, without necessarily like grappling with the social elements of it, is that is the idiosyncrasies of the first past the post system, right?
Right.
So it's rooted in the idea that you need to get just one more vote than the next person, right?
Yeah.
And even if that means there are 100 votes and there are like 98 candidates, the person with two votes can win, right?
Yes.
And so I think that that's not to sort of diminish or the relevance in thinking about caste in politics, but it's also complicated by the way in which the first party post system plays out. So at some level, yes, it is about getting a bunch of caste onto your side.
Right.
But what has also happened, interestingly, in the digital realm is that you need to get a bunch of individuals on your side. And
right.
in a certain way, what the digital allows you to do is both amplify caste, so to the extent that caste is relevant, you can use it,
yeah.
but also in a certain way, it allows you to delegitimize that and then focus on everybody as an atomized individual. I think I'll rest it at that and hand it over to Sarthak, because it's a difficult question to answer, so I'm just batting the more hard ones along
right.
to him.
Right.
But a caste is a whole episode in itself. I think
right.
caste in Bihar politics is a whole episode in itself. So I think, yeah, over to Sarthak.
Right. So, I can't duck under this, duck out this one. But the point is, caste is definitely a very important reality of politics. And it's not only in Bihar, but it's also in other states. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I studied in Maharashtra, and there, like, you know, the dominant caste narrative is very much there. And I mean, there is a very entrenched.
I'll give you an example, right? In my own state, Andhra Pradesh, TDP appeases to one caste, and Congress appeases to the ready caste, right? It's so black and white.
Right. And the idea that, if I link it to what Sari was talking about, so the idea basically gets linked to the idea of a numerical preponderance, right? Or numerical majority, which arises out of the simple majority system of FTDP, right? Of FPTP, sorry. So the point is that it is about, I mean, to my mind, it is also about resources, that how basically are you well placed to stake claim on the resources? And in that sense, which identity helps you in staking that claim to the resources that the state has to offer, right? In a state in which there is no diversification of resources, then one identity becomes the sole, the sole kind of, apparatus through which you can stake claim over those resources, right? If we say that the idea of the OBCs or the Mandal politics, aftermath of the Mandal politics, right, and the rise of the backward class politics happened in Bihar, it was also because at that point in time, what are the resources that Bihar has to offer, right? Bihar does not have much private industries or diversified resources. In that sense, whether it is the state level political economy or local political economy, it is somewhere revolving around control, and that control comes from caste, right, which is the dominant force in that local area, right? Whether it is sand mining by the Bhumihars or the Rajputs in Bhojpur, or whether it is farming, small level farming by Yadavs in Purnia or in Madhepura, right? So it, or whether it is the domination of the Maithil Brahmins and Bhumihars in Samastipur or Darbhanga, right? So it depends on basically control and access to these state resources or resources which are there, right? And which is why we see that when Lalu Prasad Yadav was, able to mobilize, caste, or, caste is as a marker of identity, to use it as a kind of an antagonistic to the other. Right. It was also very important to find out who the other is, right?
Yeah.
So Lalu's identity of caste politics was not only about caste politics in itself, but it was also about resisting the other. So he basically, the slogan was Bhura Bal Hatao. So that basically means that Bhumihar, Rajput, Brahman and Lala. So these four castes, which are the elites or the upper caste, right? Or so these have to be removed for the takeover of the state and takeover of the entire resources by the numerical majority.
Right.
So that was the narrative. Now Nitish Kumar comes from a very numerically marginal caste, you would say, because he's from Kurmi. Which is an intermediary caste, which is a very it is a prosperous caste because it has taken up to farming and education as well. So they are good farmers. They have good product production, but also many of them are actually absentee farmers. They give it on rent, and they are actually in many various government posts and other positions in the cities in Delhi and Bombay and other places. So Kurmis have a very good upward mobility also, and they are a very prosperous caste in that sense. But again, it's an intermediary caste, so it is also falling in that backward, right? But then, because of their proximity, their proximity to power, which has happened through Nitish Kumar, they are also like seen as a important player in the rural economy. But again, they are I would say that they are also not as dominant as the Yadavs are, because Yadavs are also present in that area. So they are also living there, and they are owning the land, but also living there. So that happens, that has an impact, right?
Right.
But the point is, because Nitish had a limited reach in terms of his own caste, he basically reached out to created new constituencies. So he created the most backward class. Then he created the Mahadalit. Then the idea of the women, reservation in panchayats, right? The idea of the EBCs. And again, within Muslims also, the categorization of the Pasmanda Muslim, which again, we see that actually the BJP also has been using that. So BJP has to become this kind of a system-defining party in India, right? What Rahul Verma and others call it, right? The system-defining party. To become the system-defining party, BJP has actually had to reach out to very different caste combinations than it traditionally had been.
Right.
And that included castes the segments of, jatis, which basically are the non-beneficiaries of this kind of an upward mobilization, what actually Yogendra Yadav calls as a second democratic upsurge, right? So those people, jatis which were left behind, were actually then catered to or, called out to or reached out to by the BJP and then mobilized. And they did it in Bihar also.
Right.
So in Bihar in 2015 also, BJP actually got a lot of Dalit votes.
Yeah.
So we say that, Lalu and Nitish, and again, BJP would not actually go with the Dalits would not identify with the BJP, but it actually got a lot of Dalit votes. So we have to also understand that caste is a reality. It is a very important political reality, but it is a way, it is a marker of identity which is related to the access to resources.
Right.
And which is where this idea comes that, I mean, let's look at this caste called the subcaste actually called the Sahanis or the Nishad, mm-hmm. right? And I've been following their politics for like about 6-7 years now. And so this new party has emerged, right? And this subcaste is actually a constituent of about 22 subcastes. So there's a Nishad is a community, and the Nishad community has about 22 subcastes from the EBC, which is the extremely backward caste, right? But the point is that they have got some representation within the BJP or the JDU, but then there is also this idea that we should have our own representative. When we are the numerically preponderous caste, we are basically getting, you know, a lot of the votes for other parties. And the idea is that when we are making leaders for other parties, why not we make leaders for our own party?
Yeah.
So that is also the idea. And that happens even now, like even in 2015, or actually we will have in 2020, we will have new parties which are emerging on the basis of caste coming out in Bihar.
Right.
So if people say that, you know, caste is nothing and development is a thing, I mean, it's all a bumchum. So that is, that never stands. So even by 2020, we are having new parties which are caste-based, which are emerging in the electoral foray. So that actually goes to show that, you know, it is a reality.
Right.
Yeah, and it's also a dynamic reality in that sense, right? It's not something that is fixed in time. And if you look at the example of Tamil Nadu, and to some extent even Andhra Pradesh does have instances of smaller parties that command smaller number of seats, which they then use to Sarthak's point, to access resources through negotiating with. Because if coalitions are a reality and then there are certain parties that have smaller number of seats that can tip the balance of power, then it allows caste groups to express their identity through this sort of political expression. So
right.
I think it's something to keep in mind and thinking about the dynamics of caste in
Does anyone of you see 2017 UP style vote consolidation for any group by any chance in this election?
I do not see that personally, because
right.
I think Bihar has had much more reasons of dissatisfaction than UP had in 2017. Mm. Of course, the relevance of government schemes are still standing in Bihar.
Right.
The Ujjwala Gas Yojana and other pension schemes and other things have been there. And again, Nitish's image as the Sushasan Babu or good governance guy has still standing. But I think it has had, there have been many chips in that image,
right.
Whether it be the flood in Bihar or even the flood in Patna, which was very badly handled, right? Before the floods in Bihar. And now even the COVID situation now. So again, there can be corrective narrative postures and everything. But we know that in Bihar, actually, and I'm also surprised, I mean, with the decision to go ahead with the poll, because the example is given of South Korea and Sri Lanka, that if Sri Lanka can do and South Korea can do, why not in Bihar, right?
Yeah.
The WHO, according to the WHO standard, there is a idea of how many doctors are needed for 1,000 population, right?
Yeah.
At least 2,000. So South Korea has that about 1.5 or 2, right? And Sri Lanka has that close to 1, which is about 0.8 or 0.9, right?
Mm.
Can you imagine how many doctors are there for 1,000 people in Bihar? So it's somewhere in the 0.000, because in Bihar, there is one doctor for 43,000 people, right? So that is the kind of level of, worst state of health infrastructure, public health infrastructure that we are looking at. So imagine how, this campaigning, these crowded spaces and other things will lead to. I mean, this is basically, everybody is just pushing on their luck of invincibility.
Yeah.
I don't really see a scientific logic or a kind of, even an administrative logic behind this, behind the election.
Right. To be right. Sarthak, I don't know, we, the uninitiated listeners from the South, can you please tell us who is the constant loyal base of JDU and constant loyal base of RJD? And then we can move the question to Sarayu and see what appeasement is being done on the national level media to, you know, entice these bases.
I am one of those listeners. So I'm looking to learn from Sarthak on Bihar as much as I can.
No, so
let's take it from the RJD, bottom, Sarthak. Yeah.
Yeah. So if you look at RJD, the major castes in Bihar, like we have about the upper caste, we have Brahmins, we have the Bhumihars and the Rajputs, which are comprising about largely the upper caste, and that's not more than about 5 to 6% of the entire population. Then in the intermediary caste, which is the which also falls in the OBCs, right? We have the Kurmis, like I said, which is about 3 to 3.5% of the population. We also have about Yadav, which is a very important caste in Bihar, because Yadav is about 11% of the population. Again, all of these are based on loose calculations or loose extrapolations out of the 1931 caste-based census.
Right.
Because the new one has been done, but the data has not yet been revealed as like much other data, right? The point is, Yadavs are important because also not only of their numerical preponderance, but also because of their geographic spread. Mm-hmm. So if you look at Bihar, like from Bhojpur to Simanchal region, which is in Purnia, Kishanganj.
You're talking about east to west, west to east?
East to west. Yes, okay. Yes. So Bhojpur is in the west of Bihar, which is the Saran district and Buxar district and all. So Ara. So Ara, Buxar, Saran. So those districts, Gopalganj. So Yadav population is spread from that region in the west to the east of the state, where it goes till Madhepura, Purnia, Katihar and all. So it has a very geographic spread also, apart from having a numerical preponderance, which is where it influences, the maximum number of assembly seats.
Right.
I can say, right? So the Yadav has been a loyal voting base of RJD.
Right.
Along with the Muslim, because Lalu Prasad Yadav has also been able to create a very, good kind of a secular image to himself. Again, I'm not going into the debate about the idea of the word secular and all that, but
right.
He has been able to, under his regime, there have not been many communities.
There have been instances that have appeased them,
Again, like to say appease is a yeah, but I mean, let's say that, he has avoided any kind of a blatant communal, confrontation when he was in power, whenever he has been in power. Right. So that is something which has also endeared Muslims to him. Right. Mm. But again, we see that there are also divisions within that, because BJP has tried to project some of their own Yadav leaders, to capture the disgruntled Yadav voters. Right.
Split the vote or something. Yeah.
Split the voters. And BJP has also the Union Minister, Home Minister for State is Nityanand Rai, who's he was not a very big leader. He was not a very big leader, but he is a Yadav leader who is being projected now again in the narrative as a Yadav face in the center. Then you have the Pasmanda Muslims also, again a chunk of the Muslims which have been supporting the JDU and Nitish Kumar because of certain kind of a policy level, initiative, favorable policy initiatives which are taken up by Nitish Kumar.
Right.
So RJD has had some corrosion from that MY Samikaran, but largely it has a hold on the MY, which is the Muslim and the Yadav.
Right.
BJP has been definitely with the upper caste people have actually been voting for the BJP, which has also been the Brahmins, but also Rajputs. Mm. And Rajputs are a very important category for BJP. But again, the population size is limited. But again, because of them being the vocal caste or the dominating caste, right? Not the dominant caste, but the dominating caste in many local areas, they are also able to control and influence the political discourse. So they are also influential. It will be definitely more advantageous to have the influential caste in its poll. And right. BJP has been having that advantage also for some time. And we, like we said, that in 2015 also, it had reached out to the Dalits, and it is also trying to get, the scrape through a lot of the, disgruntled elements from different caste groups, right. With including the EBCs. But the major portion of the EBC, which is actually the most dominant, caste, because it contains a lot of jatis within itself. Hmm. And that actually still goes with Nitish Kumar, with the Janata Dal United. Right. And that has a major chunk of the population, about 30-35% of the population. And that is still going with Nitish Kumar government. Because again, under the Nitish Kumar government, the many of the developmental schemes and redistributive schemes have directly benefited this community.
Right.
So the EBCs have been somewhere at the focal point of Nitish's administrative decisions.
Yeah.
So that is broadly speaking that kind of a caste based distribution,
right,
of the major players in India.
Right. Sarayu, in our Indian politics, right, just like in US politics, there is something called a swing state which decides the election, right? There is a red, there is a blue, and there is a swing, right? So do we have a swing base in any sense? Because, for example, if you take the example of Andhra, right? So the Kama caste goes with the TDP, the Reddy caste goes with the YRCCP, and there is this all the battle is about the ones who are in the middle, which can swing the either way, right? Is that the case in India? Is that a valid case in India?
Yeah, I think, the first thing to remember in India is not all conflicts are bipartisan, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas in the US, it's two predominant parties, and it's the same in the UK. So it's easier in a certain way to identify swing voters because they're swinging between sort of two extremes.
Right.
Here, typically, it's a multi-cornered contest. If you think about states like Uttar Pradesh, actually, most contexts, with the exception of a few, are multi-cornered, multipolar contests. So the idea of a swing voter is harder to discern, but definitely exists. Otherwise, you would, you could extrapolate demography to electoral results and then be absolutely certain very early on as to the ways in which elections are sort of moving. The idea of the party, the non-decided or the swing voter is very much apparent in ground level politics, right? Because it's a big question in the literature, and Sarthak's work is on this. Like, the big question in the literature on ground level politics is, who does a local politician target their ministrations towards, right? Do they focus on loyal voters? Do they focus on opposing party voters? Or do they focus on people that they think can be converted over the course of their next election? Empirically, the answer has varied. And I think it's very much, the answer to that question is fairly embedded in the context. But there are specific strategies that local politicians adopt very consciously to target voters who are undecided.
Right.
They will direct benefits towards them. They also, particularly closer to the elections, this becomes more apparent. There is more sort of patronage flowing, more benefits that flow. Government schemes where discretion lies at the lowest level of political of elected officials are then sort of diverted to those individuals that might belong to these swing categories.
Right.
So I think definitely, otherwise you would have direct extrapolations for elections. But I think it's more complicated to identify, and it's very contextual as to who is a swing voter at what point of time.
Hmm. And the current the events that are being highlighted, chased by the media right now, who do you think they are targeted towards? Are they targeted to, are the purpose of them is to like keep their loyal base intact, or they want to just extract a new, or it has no connection with the upcoming Bihar elections? What do you think, Saraya?
I think it's a hard thing to answer. I think, like, I seem to be saying this with most questions, but I think there's a national character to news.
Yeah.
So it might just as it might, and you know, I again bat it towards Sarthak to answer it with much more sort of contextual understanding. But I think what I also see is that this is in the national news, so it's
right.
Bihar elections are front and center, but there's also the pandemic, which is something that could be reported upon, while there's something else that seems to be dominating media discussions. And there's, you know, it's not just the pandemic, there's a lot of things that could be reported, that could be highlighted. There's a huge amount of rural distress, right? Somebody joked that there were journalists at one actress's house in the airports in Bombay and Goa from where this person was traveling back and forth. And that one day is the number of journalists doing that work or covering that story is more than the number of journalists deployed in rural India in the last 70 years. Right. So whether that's factually true or not, you know,
we get the joke. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like there's a billion people with very many other problems. So I wouldn't just foreground Bihar as the reason, but it's definitely predominant. And I think that it serves to, in a certain way, take away from any failures of the existing government. So it could serve that interest. It could also provide a distraction.
Right.
There could be caste arithmetic that might be playing in. So like Sarthak pointed out earlier, there's a BJP poster that says, we will not forget, we will not let you forget. So I think it's quite complicated.
So Sarthak, do you also feel the same? It is not really blatantly about Bihar election?
So can you just explain the question or repeat the question again? I think I did not understand it in the first.
So the current narrative that is being pushed in the media on such a large and unnecessary scale, is it really going to have any effect on any base in Bihar in any consequential way?
So there are parts of it which may be used and espoused by political parties to fall into a narrative, right?
Right.
And why that's so, I'll also explain that to you. The part is about the death of this big star, right? Sushant Singh Rajput.
And he belongs to Rajput.
Yeah, I just mentioned the caste also equation to you before, so you can definitely do the calculations there.
Right.
But again, it is, like I said, numerically, it won't be much benefiting, right? But sentimentally, it might be benefiting. Why? Because it also leads to another big narrative, which has been in the play for since at least last two elections, which is the Bihari versus the Bahari. And that is something, a very important card, which has always been played out, right? The Bihari versus the Bahari. And in 2015, this Bahari was basically Narendra Modi and Amit Shah. And they were seen, projected as the Bahari, and Nitish and Lalu were the Betas of Bihar, right? Because they were together in an alliance.
Right.
And that was the agenda of Bihari versus Bahari. And at that point in time, I think Narendra Modi, in one of his campaign speeches, had said something about his DNA, right? About Nitish Kumar's DNA, right? Something about that, to that effect. And Nitish spun that around, and he made it into a kind of a question mark on Bihar's DNA.
Right.
That his DNA is Bihar's DNA, and any question on his DNA is basically a kind of a remark or a conjecture to Bihar's DNA.
Taste of his own medicine.
Basically, yeah, and which became the kind of a most emotive issue, that Bihari versus Bahari.
Right.
Sorry. So this time around, the same Bihari versus Bahari. So Bahari is being the Bollywood and other things, and Bihari is the is Sushant Singh Rajput, the deceased. And that is where this fits into the larger narrative and becomes an issue. If you look at this very viral rap video, right, by one of the famous Bhojpuri singers, which is about this DGP, former DGP of Bihar Police, Gupteshwar Pandey, who has been in the news. And that rap video continuously, it actually very blatantly shows that Sushant Singh Rajput was killed, and then allegedly, doesn't even use allegedly, it very confirms that he was killed, and only Gupteshwar Pandey as the DGP was able to secure the CBI and that is how he is actually resurrecting the pride of Bihar and everything else. Because again, because now this time Narendra Modi and Amit Shah cannot be the Bahari. So there has to be a new invention of a Bahari.
Yeah.
So that is, you know, consistent narrative, but different actors. So that is where this is playing out. But again, the larger things, like Saryu said, it is not, it is definitely seems like, you know, definitely it appears like a kind of a cover, right?
Yeah.
And again, the Bahari point is again being used by Narendra Modi in his tweets to the ruckus in Rajya Sabha with the farmers' bill.
Right.
So the deputy speaker of Rajya Sabha is basically Harivansh, right? Who is a Bihari, who's from Bihar. He was the editor, chief editor of Prabhat Khabar, one of the leading dailies in Bihar. So Harivansh, so any kind of insult to Harivansh is being seen as an insult to Bihar.
Right.
And it is done by the Bahari or with the outside MPs of Congress or Trinamool Congress and other things. So the narratives are being, like, you know, same, but the actors are being reinvented so that it can be used more effectively to play out on the ground.
Right.
But again, jobs are not there. I mean, the youth are actually almost, you know, revolting in their protest. And unfortunately or fortunately for the digital space has given them only one tool, which is the dislike option.
Right.
And many of these, you know, live debates or live kind of samvad or inauguration, even Prime Minister's inauguration, I was actually witnessing that on Facebook Live. And I saw that many people are actually putting the dislike option. Many young boys are coming in, writing some comment and just... So I think that anonymity of the digital space has also empowered them in a sense that they say their point to the Prime Minister, which is the highest authority on the land, but yet remain unaccountable for their comment and just run away with after a dislike. So it's like basically how we used to light crackers.
Right.
In childhood, we would light it from a distance and then run away to witness the explosion.
Right.
So, I mean, this is something similar. This reminds me of that analogy that, you know, they put the dislike button and then they run away to their own complacency.
Right.
But I think whether that will have an electoral impact or not, it is for all of us to see.
Right.
But I think these deflection strategies are also very well at play.
Yeah.
And the media management, of course. So,
right.
I mean, I don't know if I've been helpful in answering that, but this is how my perspective on the issue.
Sarthak, you speak of their discontent. Which areas have been massively affected by the floods, and whose votes are that going to affect exactly?
So the floods are actually displaced about more than 60 lakh people. And it is largely in the Kosi region. So the Kosi basically is known as, Bihar Soro.
Okay.
So Kosi has been, I mean, it is not again the first time which the floods have devastated. And in fact, in 2010 and 11, the floods were even more severe in nature.
Right.
At that time, Nitin actually won many accolades and laurels, and even from the United Nations and other places, for his adept handling of the floods.
Right.
And for making control rooms in the district levels and other things, and for being very effective.
Right.
But somehow that kind of an effectiveness was not seen here. We also, I mean, it also, like, you know, the administrative memory of the state seems to be so weak that it completely forgets what it has done and how it has overcome things. Look at a scene like Orissa. Because of the repeated cyclones, the number of fatalities or casualties that we find in Odisha cyclones, whenever a massive cyclone hits Odisha, is negligible nowadays, right? Because of the administrative memory of the state being very strong, and they are able to do that. Any country in the Southeast Asia which has been able to handle COVID-19 better, right, than other countries, has been on the basis of a very, very strong administrative memory. It completely bewilders me that why Bihar fails to have that kind of an administrative memory,
right,
wherein with regards to the floods, wherein they become almost like an annual recurrence now, right?
Yeah.
So people who were in the low-lying area, again, the most disadvantaged people, many of them belong to the EBCs. Like I said, people living close to the river, the Sahanis or the Nishad community, the EBCs, those who depend on the river for their livelihood are also living close to the river.
Right.
So their lives and livelihoods are being affected directly. So they will definitely, there will be an impact on, you know, whether they will be, you know, voting for the JDU or for Nitish Kumar or not. Again, having said that, the problem is that whether they are actually finding a good alternative or not.
Right.
So that also.
Right.
So there is a lot of positive voting, but there is also the idea of the negative voting.
Mm-hmm.
And in Bihar, it happens a lot. So many times, even without having an alternative, people do vote. Because if they don't want to vote for someone, they will not want to vote for someone.
Right.
So that is also something very typical of Bihar.
Right.
We say that many times that, you know, there is no alternative, so BJP will eventually win. But in Bihar, in the previous elections also, we have seen that if they don't want any party to win, they will actually make sure that it happens.
Sarayu, can you remind us of any examples where a natural disaster has really unseated a government or, you know, affected a massive amount of vote swing, right? Like, for example, any floods in any state or any cyclone. So will the pandemic and the flood, you know, have definitely, it should have an effect, right? In which way the vote swings?
I would... No example comes to mind. Sarthak, again, if there's something that pops into your memory, do let me know. I think the evidence on disasters actually affecting elections is quite mixed.
Hmm.
There are instances, there's a whole lot of, like a whole body of economic research that examines the relationship between economic performance, natural disasters, and sort of electoral outcomes, and tries to do this in a quantitative way.
Right.
But the answer is complicated. Like, it doesn't necessarily translate into unseating a government.
Hmm.
It can also, like, elections are multi-causal. So
right.
If a government gets unseated, did it happen in the same places or the same sort of like that, drawing that direct linkage is complex, at least theoretically.
Right.
I think what is more easily, I guess, quantifiable, and I think Sarthak referred to that much earlier, is the point around incumbency. So if it's been 10 years or if it's been 15 years, the dissatisfactions run deeper.
Mm.
And what events such as a flood can do is to widen those gaps and
right.
make it more apparent.
Right.
So, did a flood unseat a government? I mean, I don't know, like, it sounds like a headline, but
yeah.
As an academic, I would be a little wary of, like, concluding from A to B.
Right. One important question, again, anyone can choose to answer. Importance of having a chief ministerial face, right? It has worked in different ways. In UP, BJP won without a chief ministerial face, and BJP lost without chief minister face in Bihar. And now UPA is not having a chief minister face. So how do you feel this is going to play out?
So, I mean, if I can weigh in on this, sorry.
Right.
In UP, in 2017, I mean, apart from like Akhilesh Yadav, who was again, I mean, having that face was a disadvantage in itself for the Samajwadi Party because of severe anti-incumbency. But barring that, the opposition also, like Congress, did not have any chief minister face, right?
Right.
And BJP, of course, did not have a chief minister face. But in Bihar, it's I would again say that different states in India have different, different kind of politics also is happening. And in Bihar, the face has always been Nitish Kumar for some time, at least, for the past, three elections, at least, on a stretch.
Right. Right.
And that is something that it has a kind of a brand value, and it has a kind of a value which is based on the assurance of delivery or deliverance, right? And it has been a tried and tested face, which is why, I mean, the face, the value of this face is so much that whether it is Lalu in coalition or whether it is Modi, Narendra Modi in coalition, both of them support Nitish as the face.
Right.
And these are all coming from very different ideological backgrounds. Right? Lalu and Narendra Modi can be almost, polar opposites.
Yeah.
Right? But then these are both standing together with Nitish as the face. So we have to also understand that the importance of this face is definitely there.
Hmm.
Now, having said that, over three terms, over a lot of these administrative failures and the kind of handling misgovernance. And also, I think if your calling card is that of being an administrator,
right.
that is your strong point, right? That is your USP, right? You're not a charismatic person, and yeah. I've attended many rallies by Nitish Kumar. He has anything but charisma. He has no charismatic presence, and definitely when compared to Lalu, his oratorial skills are also very boring. In fact, yeah. Nikesh's speeches are always laden with facts and figures and, you know, data, which bores an audience, right?
So there is no viral Modiji Nas Phat Jayega speeches coming out of Nitish Kumar.
No, nothing. Lalu knows his audience.
Yeah.
And Lalu knows them. So, in fact, I have actually seen women running barefoot to catch a glimpse of Lalu, because his helicopter arrived 10 minutes earlier than scheduled in one of the rallies that he was doing in Muzaffarpur in 2015. And I've never seen that happening, right? In Modi rallies, people are coming in and going, and they just see and they just... I'm terribly sorry. Sorry. They just come and go, and they just register their presence of having attended this one big point, that is a Modi rally. Right, because they have to tell that story back home. But Lalu rally is something very different. And Nitish rally is, again, as I said, it can be boring. So he does not have charisma, but he has the deliverance and he has an administrative sense, right? But what happened with the COVID-19? He fell short on his strongest point. There was a reluctance from him to govern at all. It seemed like that, right? First of all, he was quarantined in his house for 90 days. After that, he came out in public, right? Before that, he was, I don't know what he was, he had gone into self-meditation or something. He was, even the students who are studying in Kota and in other places in Rajasthan, right? The Bihar was unwilling to even, like, you know, I mean, migrants, of course, no state was doing that.
Yeah.
But other states were at least catering to the middle class students, right? Bihar stood out in that, like, you know, very differently, because it was even refusing to own anybody who was a Bihari. And then, surprisingly, we call that Bihari versus Bahari is the selling point or is the focal point of the narrative. But it was actually refusing to own any kind of Bihari who was outside of the limits of the state.
Right.
So, when that is your calling card, and when you fall short on one of your strong points, I think your image also gets a little bit of a beating. And that has happened. So we are having, like, you know, kind of a... So again, whether this beating is strong enough or big enough for Tejasvi to come in and occupy that position, or even for that matter, Chirag Paswan to come in and occupy that position, that will be something which is, I don't think, which is happening now. It will take some more time. Maybe Chirag Paswan needs some more administrative experience and, of course, a lot of other things to be able to get up to that position.
Right.
But definitely we would see that probably this may be towards the end of Nitish's appeal as an administrator after this election.
Right.
Yeah. And just to add to that, I think, you know, a more general point, not necessarily rooted in Bihar politics, is in any chief minister, like at least in an assembly election, the existing candidate, right, it's a referendum on the existing government. So very likely that the existing candidate, unless they expressly declare that this person is not the face, then it changes the name of the game. But, you know, everywhere it's that this person is being re-elected. So the claim from the ruling party is to say re-election, and then the opposing parties try to destroy it. Now, then the question of what do the opposing parties then say, right? So for them, it's a strategy.
Right.
And the strategy has several advantages and disadvantages, right? It depends on who, it depends on who you're up against. There are some times where it's actually advantageous to not have a face and allow the elections to be framed by the central government, right? So if there is a Modi appeal, why wouldn't the BJP in various state elections capitalize on it, right?
Yeah.
Would a local face, unless it's a very strong face, like in MP or in Chhattisgarh, take away from the success of the party, right? So, for example, in Karnataka, I mean, there is Yediyurappa here, so it's a slightly different debate, right? But the direct projection of the face is, like, you'll always try to leverage some kind of other You know, like in the case of the BJP, you would leverage sort of the prime minister, you would leverage right. the broader sort of government. So the answer is the chief, like selecting a chief minister face a winner or a loser is very much a question of strategy. But right. typically for the incumbent party, it's inevitable because it's a referendum on them. And then therefore, if you observe also, like, sorry, local government, like incumbent parties will adopt strategies to frame the elections around their candidate, right? So for example, if you take Karnataka, right, a lot of what they did in the Karnataka elections in 2018 was to say, Siddaramaiah is successful, what he did was amazing, blah, 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 tried to localize the election as much as possible, while the BJP was trying the exact opposite. So, I mean, yeah, it's as much strategic as it is, like, it's mostly strategic, I would say, and therefore contextual as well.
Yeah, I mean, just another thing that, I mean, whenever a party or national party or a regional party, of course, they will have the different motivations of projecting a regional leader, right? We see that regional parties are actually more adept at putting the name of the, you know, declaring the chief minister candidate because they're the, I mean, it's usually the de facto leader who right. will become the chief minister face, like it was for Jagan Mohan Reddy, right? So he was the face of the YSRCP, and in that case, he was projected. But projecting Devendra Fadnavis as the chief minister, as the face for the second time for the right. BJP, did not prove to be successful, right? Because even though BJP was the largest party, but again, we see that, and in that case, it's very important also to see their acceptability of that chief ministerial face to other within the party as well as in the coalition.
Right.
So that became also a kind of a confrontation point. And in that sense, Nitish Kumar's face is also by and large acceptable. And this has happened also because Nitish has never let anybody rise above him in Bihar politics. And that is something which is very important. We have to also understand the way Nitish governs and functions is very important. Even though he has been in power for three terms, many of our MLAs are not three-term MLAs, right? He always changes the MLAs. Those MLAs who have been for three-term MLAs are also not so powerful, right? And nobody has a bigger image than Nitish Kumar. Right. So if we talk about the MLA development, area development fund, right? And many of the MLAs are famous for or become kind of known in the constituency for the kind of development work that they get done from that fund. Nitish centralized that fund and made it into a Mukhyamantri Vikas development fund.
Right.
So all the kind of activities like school kon diya, Nitish diya. Rasta kon diya, Nitish diya. Right? Now only after Raghuvansh Singh died, we are saying that a lot of NREGS schemes and the roads were being made by Raghuvansh Babu. But when everybody is alive, Nitish is the sole,
enabler.
Enabler and he's the only delivery person in Bihar. Right. So that also he has cut the strength of all the other political leaders and limited, cut them down to size.
Right. So I think we have as much a fascinating conversation this is. So I think we would have to bring this to an abrupt end. Before letting you guys go, who are you betting your savings on in Bihar election if you had to?
I've learned the hard way not to bet my savings on anything. So, no predictions really. I think this in a certain way has been a little bit invisible as an election. Like the visibility has been mediated very much through the channels I consume. And to Sarthak's earlier point, there are these bubbles and I really don't know if in any way it's possible to get a true picture to be able to make that kind of prediction. I'm going to duck out of this one.
So, I have negligible savings to bet on.
Yeah.
But still going forward, so again, I'm also not in the prediction business. So, I'm not a cephalologist. I'm an ethnographer, so I understand and try to study elections for different reasons. But the point is that, I mean, given the state of affairs that it exists.
The point I'm getting to is who has an advantage is what the point I'm getting to.
I think the incumbent here has an advantage because of different factors. And despite the different drawbacks and different kind of shortcomings that we have just listed. But I think the incumbents have an advantage. But I can also bet that on 10th of November at least, Sushant Singh Rajput will definitely get some justice. So I think at least
that case will come to a close. Yeah.
Hopefully that. Right. Because whether irrespective of whoever comes to power, hopefully that case should get, justice should be delivered in that aspect. But in all seriousness, I think the advantage is clearly for the incumbent. But there is a very strong push from the opposition also. Right. Let's see how that unfolds in the next 2 months.
Perfect. Thank you very much for joining, Sarayu. Thank you very much for joining, Sathak. If anyone has been listening this long, I'm sure you must be from Bihar. If not from Bihar, I will be extra delighted. Thank you very much for tuning into this podcast, ladies and gents. That's it from Saluka Bursa. Until we see you next time. Bye, everyone.